Paramhansa Hansa Parivrajikachar Shotrasat, His Divine Grace Abhay Charanaravinda Bhakti Vedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai, Ananta Koti Vaishnava Vrinda Ki Jai, Shri Shri Gandharvika Giridhari Shriman Mahaprabhu Ki Jai, Shri Lakshmi Narasimha Dev Ananta Dev Ki Jai, Shri Prahlad Narasimha Ki Jai, Granthraj Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Shri Narasimha Chaturdashi Maha Mahotsava ki jai, Nitai Gaur Premanande. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories, all glories, all glories to Sri Guru and Gauranga. You can announce it. Kannada translation at the back.
Kannada anuvada hindigade ide daivuttu kannada anuvada bekagiro hindigade Hare
Krishna. Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya. Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya. Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya. Narayanam namaskritya. Naram chaiva narottamam. Devim sarasvatim vyasam. Tato jayamudirayet. Nashta Paishu Abhadeshu Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya Bhagavat Yuttama Shloke Bhaktir Bhavati Naishthiki. Om Ajnana Timirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yenatasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Dam Mahyam Dadati Svapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yutapadakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathan Bitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadhutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padang Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhan Bitam Scha Namo Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Preshtaya Bhutle Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swamin Nitinamine Namaste Saraswate Deve Gauravani Pracharine ನಿರ್ವಿಶೇಷ ಶೂನ್ಯವಾದಿ ಪಾಶ್ಚಾತ್ಯ ದೇಶ ತಾರಿಣೇ ವಾಂಛಾಕಲ್ಪತರುಭ್ಯಶ್ಚ ಕೃಪಾಸಿಂಧುಭ್ಯ ಏವ ಚ ಪತಿತಾನಾಂ ಪಾವನೇಭ್ಯೋ ವೈಷ್ಣವೇಭ್ಯೋ ನಮೋ ನಮಃ. ಜಯ ಶ್ರೀ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಚೈತನ್ಯ ಪ್ರಭು ನಿತ್ಯಾನಂದ ಶ್ರೀ ಅದ್ವೈತ ಗದಾಧರ ಶ್ರೀವಾಸಾದಿ ಗೌರಭಕ್ತವೃಂದ. ಹರೇ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಹರೇ ಕೃಷ್ಣ 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 ಹರೇ ಹರೇ, ಹರೇ ರಾಮ ಹರೇ ರಾಮ 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 ಹರೇ ಹರೇ. ಹರೇ ಕೃಷ್ಣ. ಟುಡೇ ಇಸ್ ದ ವೆರಿ ಆಸ್ಪಿಷಿಯಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಹೋಲಿ ಡೇ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಅಪಿಯರೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ Lord Narasimhadev. We are going to have many, many festivities today, including Abhishek later on in the morning. In the afternoon, we will have discussion about Lord Narasimhadev's appearance. But today, in the morning, it is nice to have some discussion about Prahlad Maharaj. Because Prahlad is a reason for the Lord's advent. If Prahlad had not been here, then the Lord would not have advented. And you can never separate the Lord from his devotee. It is because the Lord is Bhakta Vatsala, always very affectionate to his devotees, that he can never separate himself from his devotees. So the Lord is never alone. He is always with his devotees. In any of his incarnations, the Lord likes to engage in relationships of love with his devotees. We do not like to be alone. We always want to be with somebody. That is why those jnana yogis who manage to reach the impersonal Brahma Jyoti, often they can't stay there because there is no rasa there. Rasa means there is no mellow of relationship there. There is just existence. And just mere existence, even if it is without the sufferings of material existence, is not completely satisfying. What the soul is hankering for is real love. And that love is possible only in relationship to the Supreme Lord. So therefore, when the jiva engages in the devotional service of the Lord, then automatically all sorts of happiness arise in the heart, a kind of transcendental happiness, a happiness that cannot be experienced in this world. Wherever there are discussions about devotional service or bhakti, there must be discussion about Prahlad. In the Srimad Bhagavatam, the 7th canto, chapter 4, Narad Muni and Yudhishthira Maharaj have a discussion on the glories of Prahlad. And it is mentioned that wherever and whenever, in any planet of the universe, there is discussion on devotional service or bhakti, definitely Prahlad's name is also mentioned. Other devotees may or may not be mentioned, but Prahlad's name is definitely mentioned. And remember, he reached the peak of his devotion. Of course, in devotional service, the peak just goes on increasing. But he was an exalted Paramahamsa devotee even at the age of 5. In India, it is a very common objection. When young people take to devotional life, their relatives and friends many times offer objections. And they say, this is not the age to do devotional service. So when these young people come and they say, you know, this is how our elders, our relatives, gurus, etc., speaking to us that this is not the age for doing devotional service, for starting it. So I said, you tell them, yes, you are right. This is not the age for starting devotional service. I am 20 years old now. I am 15 years late. Like Prahlad, I should have started when I was 5 years old. So you are absolutely right that this is not the right age for starting. I should have started when I was 5 years old. But you did not give me the opportunity to start. You did not give me those devotional sanskars. So this is a great myth and an unfortunate thing in India, the land of spiritual culture, where everybody, anybody tries to dissuade you from serious devotional service. If you go occasionally once in a while, then it's all right. But the moment you start taking to devotional service seriously, like Prahlad, then everybody starts getting objection. Oh, you are too young. Whatever age you are too young. I met one gentleman who was 58 years old, and his relatives were telling him he was too young. So what to do? One time, one gentleman came to see Srila Prabhupada. His son, who was quite young, he had wanted to, he had become a serious devotee. So the father came and said, he is too young to do devotional service, to do the spiritual life. He should do it when he becomes old. So let him come back to home. So Prabhupada said, fine, if he is too young to do devotional service, let him go and you stay. Because you are old enough, he is young, but you are old, so you stay, so let him go. But of course, the gentleman did not like the proposal. Because that age for starting devotional service never comes in the minds of those who are too attached to this world. But Prahlad, by his example, teaches us that we have to start devotional service very young. Kumara Ajari Pragyo Dharman Bhagavatan Yaha Durlabham Manusham Janma Tadapya Dhruvam Arthadam. Prahlad says to his friends, my dear friends, this Bhagavata Dharma, this process of bhakti to the Supreme Lord Sri Hari, Sri Krishna, should start from Kumar, the age of Kumar, age of 5, even younger. This is the prime necessity of life. The human form of life is very meaningful, even though it is very temporary. Therefore, all of us, my dear friends, even though we are little boys, we should render service to Lord Krishna. Even at that tender age, Prahlad's devotion was extraordinary, and it perplexed everybody around him. His father definitely couldn't understand it. And even the others. Shukadev Goswami describes that Prahlad was not a frivolous child. Mostly children are frivolous by nature, very restless. And they are attached to playing. Balyastavat kridasaktaha. So in childhood one is attached to playing. But Prahlad was not frivolous, mischievous. He was always absorbed in Krishna consciousness. So he would sit quietly and he would undergo ecstatic internal transformations, because only he knew what he was experiencing. Others were just not in a position to understand. Vaishnava Kriya Mudra Vigneha Na Bhujhai. Very difficult to understand the ways of a great Vaishnava. As he sat remembering Lord Krishna with great devotion, in that remembrance sometimes tears of ecstasy would flow from his eyes. Sometimes he would see the Lord coming. Nobody else could see. Only he could see. And as Lord was approaching, then he would become jubilant and he would rise and he would shout and he would jump and dance because he could see the Lord was coming to him. When the Lord was not there, when he could not see the Lord, he would become very morose and sit down. And suddenly again when he saw the Lord, he would rise. So sometimes he would cry, sometimes he would laugh, sometimes he would dance, sometimes he would sit quietly. So others would not understand why these transformations were happening in this little child. They didn't have the faintest clue what was going on in this child's mind. And Prahlad in this way remained forever absorbed in the devotional service of the Lord. He was able to experience the loving hand of Krishna at every moment in his life. And of course, when the time came at the age of 5 for him to be sent to the school, the Gurukul, his father Hiranyakashipu sent him. The guru of the Asuras was Shukracharya. The two sons of Shukracharya were Shanda and Amarka. They became the teachers for Prahlad as well as the sons of the demoniac associates of Hiranyakashipu. So they were accustomed to teaching all sorts of mundane materialistic topics. As a dutiful student, Prahlad did whatever he was asked to do. If the teacher asked him to repeat something, he repeated it. But he had no interest at all. In his heart was always absorbed in Krishna consciousness. After some time elapsed, then Hiranyakashipu called for his son. And very loved. He raised Prahlad and seated him on his lap and stroked his head and kissed his head and said, "My dear boy, please tell me what I've learnt in the Gurukul." He was hoping or expecting that Prahlad will speak something about politics and how you should defeat the enemy and how you should become number one, something of that sort. But Prahlad had other ideas. Prahlad said, "Tasadu mani suradhinam sa samudvigna dhiya tasakrahat hitmatma patam grihamandha kupam vanam garo dharim ashrayeta." He said, "My dear father, oh, the best among the asuras, tasadu mani asura varya, varya means the best. My father, who are best amongst the demons, I think it is not befitting a person to be involved in materialistic consciousness, because anyone who accepts the untrue, that which is material, as the truth, asat grahat, one who accepts this untruth as truth, sada will always be sadvignadhat. He will always be agitated in his mind. Therefore, my dear father, one should give up." Actually, he said, "You should give up. You should give up, or one should give up a place where there is no spiritual culture. Hitva, hitva means to give up. Atma bhatam, a place where there is no spiritual culture. One should give up such place. Hitvatma patam griham andhakupam. Especially such kind of household life where there is no place for Lord Krishna. There is no spiritual culture. Such family life is a there to a deep dark well, andhakupam, where there is no water. It only appears there is water, but when you go on digging and you go searching for water, there is no water. Similarly, in materialistic family life, there is no happiness. Only imagination, there is happiness exists. Only some sense pleasure exists, minimally. So then, Prahlad says to his father, one stand at here, how not taught you these things? Where is from? Where got influenced by our enemies? And Prahlad replies very nicely. He said, oh my dear teachers, I offer my obeisances to that Supreme Lord by whose illusory energy the Maya Shakti, people in this world distinguish between friends and enemies, and they say, this person is my friend, that person is my enemy. But this duality arises only out of illusion. Really, who is anybody's friend and who is anybody's enemy? These are all temporary things that happen in this world. And Prahlad goes on speaking this, the philosophy, and says, I offer my respects to that Supreme Lord who has created such a wonderful material creation where even the creator of the world, Brahma, gets bewildered. He cannot fathom the depths of devotional service and the truths, the absolute truths of life. So what to speak of us? When Chanda and Amarka were asking him, how and why is it that you have got this deviant mentality? Prahlad explains it is not deviant mentality. One gentleman came to see me, whose young son has also become a devotee. Now this family, the immediate family and the extended family, they used to eat meat, they used to drink alcohol. The father, son, the elders, the youngsters would all sit together and drink alcohol. It was a routine thing for them. The culture in that family was like this. Father and son would sit together. They would go to the bar and together. This is the culture in the house. And maybe the relatives are also with that. The ladies will also take care of that. So this boy became a devotee. So the father was very disturbed. Even in the beginning, this was not inclined to everything his family was inclined to doing. But now when he actually stopped all this, and he started doing devotional service, then his father became agitated. He said, this boy has become a deviant. He's not doing any of these things with us. So what is drinking, eating meat, yes, all of these things. Yes, he's abnormal. So who is normal, who is abnormal? Yes? If a group drinker, somebody who is not drinking is an abnormal person. In a society of thieves, a person who is honest is an abnormal person. Who is deviant and who is not? It depends on your point of view. But if you are a civilized person, then you will understand that a society of thieves is not a good society. So, whose point of view are we looking from, are we seeing from? So, similarly, as devotees of the Supreme Lord, we understand what is reality. Reality is devotional service. For somebody who is standing in Shishasana, do you know what is Shishasana?
There is actually a community of people who are traditionally thieves. So it happens. Everybody is trained to be a thief from childhood, and that's
parampara, that's the tradition that goes on in that family. And if one person comes up who is honest, then he is condemned. So here in this family of demoniac people, Shand and Amarka were condemning Prahlad. How have you become deviant? And Prahlad starts saying, actually I am not deviant. And I am helpless, it's not my fault. And then he speaks this wonderful verse, which we have put up on the board now. It is the 14th verse from the 5th chapter of the 7th canto. And the title of this chapter is Prahlad, the saintly son of Hiranyakashipu. So let us recite this verse. Yata Bhangati Ayaha Brahman Svavam Ankausha Sandha Tapna Me Bhagyata Chetaha Chakrapaniha Yadrichayam Yadha Brahm Yatya Yadham Svayam Akasha Sannidho Tathāne Vidyate Cheta Chakrapāne Yadrichaya Yatha Brahm Yatya Yadham Svayam Akasha Sannidho Tathāne Vidyate Cheta Chakrapāne Yadrichaya Yadha Brahm Yatya Yadham Svayam Akasha Sannidho Tathāne Vidyate Chetaha Chakrapāne Yadrichaya Christ. Svayam Akasha Sannidho Yatha Brahm Yatyayo Brahman Man Akarsha Sannidhau Tathāne Bhidyate Chetaha Chakrapāṇeh Yadrichaya Yatha Brahm Yatyayo Brahman Svayam Akarsha Sannidhau Tathāne Bhidyate Chetaha Chakrapāṇeh Yadrichaya Yatha Brahm Yatyayo Brahman Svayam Akarsha Sannidhau Tathāne Bhidyate Chetaha Chakrapāṇeh Yadvachya Yatha just as Bhangmati moves Ayaha Ayam Brahman O Brahmanas Svayam itself Akasha of a magnet Sannidho in the proximity Tatha similarly me my Vidyate is changed Chetaha consciousness Chakrapanehu of Lord Vishnu who has a disc in his hand Yadvichaya simply by the will. Translation by Srila Prabhupada. O Brahmas, teachers, as I am attracted by a magnetic stone, moves automatically toward the magnet, my consciousness, having been changed by whose will is attracted by Lord Vishnu, who carries a disc
in his hand. Thus, I have no independence. So Prahlad is telling his teachers, my dear teachers, O Brahmanas, you are blaming me for what you consider to be my deviant mentality, but actually it's not my fault. I am helpless. My attraction towards Lord Krishna is automatic, it is natural, it is spontaneous. I am helplessly attracted to the Supreme Lord, just as iron is naturally attracted to a magnet. In the Bhagavad Gita also Lord Krishna says, Pula Pyaseva Tenaiva Vriyate Yavashopisaha. Because of devotional service rendered in previous lives, in this life, the yogi or the bhakti yogi becomes helplessly attracted to the process of devotional service. There is a kind of natural inclination that happens. You see, this is a mystery. Some people are very attracted naturally to the process of devotional service. And some people, even in ripe old age, to the very time of death, have an aversion towards anything spiritual or towards God. So those who have a natural attraction towards devotional way of life, we should understand that they are continuing that from their previous life. Otherwise, it is not possible to manifest or exhibit such natural attraction towards God, such natural inclinations. So Prahlad is saying, please don't blame me because it's just helpless. I have no choice in this matter. My heart is just getting automatically pulled towards Vishnu. How many of us want to be in that helpless condition? Yes. How many of us want to be deviants like Prahlad? That is the perfection of our life. Yes, the world may say you are a strange person. One time one young gentleman who became a devotee, and he was working in some company in a job. And you know the young people in the company, they're all going to the bar, they're going to the movies, they're going for here, there, the way they talk, they're, you know, their activities. And this young gentleman who was a devotee was repulsed by all these things. He didn't want to involve himself in all of these activities. So there was a lot of pressure. They would make fun of him, they would mock him in the office. Peer pressure is very powerful, whether it is school, college, whether even as adults in the social society in which you move. pressure of other people who mock you and ridicule you for doing devotional service can be very strong. It can be very upsetting. So this young gentleman came and said, you know, they are saying, he used the word weird. You know what is weird? Weird means something strange. Like out of this planet. If somebody says, you are not from this planet, I say, wonderful. Yes, you are not from this planet. You are from Vaikuntha. So I said, don't worry. Don't let these people disturb you. You continue your devotional service. The world will go in one direction. We have to go in another direction. So we want to be helplessly attracted, but we are not attracted at this point in time. That is our problem. You know, many times you would find people talking about their problems, isn't it? There is shortage of so many things in this world, but there's certainly no shortage of problems. Everybody has a long list of problems. If you sit with anybody, please tell me the problems in your life, huge list will come up. But actually our main problem, our real problem in life is that we are not attracted to Krishna like Prahlad is. That is the tragedy of our life. But the good part of it is that we are trying. We are sincerely endeavoring in this devotional service to follow in the footsteps of Prahlad. Of course, Prahlad is on a very, very exalted platform and we are just ordinary practicing devotees. But never mind. Success will be achieved today or tomorrow by the mercy of the Lord and the Guru and the other Vaishnavas. So we should continue the process of devotional service. At least we have accepted this path in all sincerity. So success will come. So this is the problem in the society. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur would also say that there is shortage of only one thing in this world, and that is Krishna consciousness. So Prahlad is giving the analogy here of iron getting attracted to a magnet. The moment the iron is brought in the proximity of the magnet, immediately it's pulled towards the magnet. It is natural. In fact, you have to exert a force to stop the iron from getting pulled towards the magnet. So similarly, when the devotee develops that spontaneous devotion for Krishna, then he or she becomes automatically attracted to Krishna. That is the perfection of our life, to develop this spontaneous attraction to Krishna. Krishna is all attractive. Srila Prabhupada mentions in the purport here, I will read a few lines. For iron to be attracted by a magnet is natural. Similarly, for all living entities to be attracted toward Krishna is natural. And therefore, the Lord's real name is Krishna, meaning he who attracts everyone and everything. You know, the Lord has many names, infinite names, but as Prabhupada mentions here, his main name is Krishna. Why so? Because the word Krishna means all attractive. Krishna bhu vachakah shabdo rashta nirkriti vachakah tayor aikyam param brahma. Then what? Param brahma iti abhidhiyate. So tayor aikyam means when these two words Krishna are put together, Krishna. Tayor aikyam, when they put together, param brahma vidhiyate. They indicate the Supreme God. The word Krish, bhuvachakah shabdah, indicates the attractive feature. And raha indicates pleasure, supreme pleasure. So when you bring Krish and Ra together, Krishna, then it means that he is the absolute truth, who is all attractive. who himself is full of pleasure and who gives transcendental pleasure to all. So therefore, God by nature is one who is all attractive. He attracts everyone and everything. And God is also all powerful, so his attraction is also all powerful. So if God is all powerful and God is all attractive, then how is it that we are not attracted to Krishna? How is it we are able, how is it that we have the power to resist the attraction of Krishna? Very important question. Did you get the question? Krishna is all attractive. Krishna is all powerful. And yet, there are millions of people who are not attracted to Krishna. Where do they get that power to be not attracted to Krishna? To resist the attraction of Krishna. Anyone? Yes. Huh? Maya Devi. So Maya is stronger than Krishna? Then? But Maya is the energy of Krishna. Daivi Isha Gurumani Mama Maya Kuratyaya. So there is only one person who can prevent us from getting attracted to Krishna, and that is Krishna. Only Krishna has the power to prevent us from getting attracted to him. Nobody else has that power. Because Krishna is all powerful and he is all attractive. So if somebody is not attracted to Krishna, it means that it is because Krishna is allowing that to happen. Not directly, but through his Maya Shakti, through the power of his illusory energy. And why like that? Because the living entities who are in this material world are here because they want to be separate from Krishna. They want to be independent of Krishna. They want to be false, independent enjoyers, proprietors, and controllers. So Krishna says, you want to live in fantasy land. So I will create a fantasy land for you. Just like you have the Disney world and this world and that world, yes? So this material world is also this fantasy world, where you can come and try to enact your fantasies of trying to be an enjoyer and a controller and proprietor. So then Krishna places that rebellious living entity under the influence of the material energy. That is why the living entities under the influence of Maya do not get attracted to Krishna. And under the influence of Maya, then there is a covering that prevents the attraction of that living entity to Krishna. Now, I will ask you one question. Iron is attracted to a magnet naturally. But can there be some condition when the iron is not attracted to the magnet? When does that happen? Opposite direction? No.
When we stop it,
okay. When there is rust, Any chemistry students here? What is it? Ferrous dioxide, something like that. Ferrous dioxide. Okay. So, when there is rust, then the rust prevents that iron from being attracted to the magnet. The natural condition of the iron is to be attracted to the magnet. But the existence of the rust is an unnatural condition that prevents the natural condition of the iron from manifesting. So because of the rust, the iron is not yet attracted to the magnet. So similarly, the natural condition of the living entity is to be attracted to Krishna. But there is a rust of lust. Rust of lust. Lust means any desire other than the desire to serve Krishna. So wherein this lust is there, the rust that prevents us being attracted to Krishna, then you have to remove that rust. If you have an iron piece that has rusted, what do you do to remove the rust? Yeah? You rub it, you file it. You keep on filing it, and the rust comes off. And to the degree that the rust comes off from the magnet, to that degree you will find the iron once again regains its natural property of being attracted to a magnet. So because of many, many millions of lives of being under the influence of Maya, we have got this rust of lust that is very strong. So we have to file it, we have to remove that rust. How do we remove it? Chetoda Paramajanam Bhavamahatavaneva Param. As Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has said in the Shikshashika prayers, by cleansing the heart by the process of devotional service and especially by chanting the holy names of the Lord. So this is the process of removing that rust from the heart. Many times people say, we have so many desires in this world. It is natural. But what you people are doing as devotees is unnatural. Because you do not want us to fulfill our natural desires in this world. But the fact of the matter is, as I indicated in the beginning of the class, for one who is standing upside down, everybody else is upside down. For a society where everything is unnatural, the unnatural seems to be natural. And the natural seems to be unnatural. So actually speaking, these sorts of tendencies are unnatural. They exist because of the rust. And devotional service is natural. So what we are doing actually is to revive the natural condition of the living entity. So the test of the degree to which we have revived our natural condition is the degree to which we have become attracted to Krishna. That is the test. How much are we attracted to Krishna? How much are we attracted to this world? That is the question. Bhakti parishan bho virakti anyatra chaishattaka eka kalaha prapatyamanasya vibhashatasyo tushti pushti kshudapayo lukhasam. In the 11th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, the 9 Yogendras mention the king Nini, that this process of bhakti is like the process of eating. With every morsel of food that you place into your mouth and you chew it, three things happen. Trika eka kalaha. They happen at one time, simultaneously. What are those three things? Tushi. You start feeling some satisfaction. Pushti, your body starts getting nourished. Kshut apayaha, your hunger starts diminishing. So all these three things start happening simultaneously. Similarly, prapatyamanasya, for one who has surrendered to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, three things happen simultaneously. What are those three things? Bhakti, love for the Supreme God. Para isha anubhavaha, experience of the Lord in one's life. And virakti anyatra, which means renunciation from anything that is not connected to Krishna consciousness. So as we do bhakti yoga, as we follow the practice of devotional service, gradually the rust is removed. We see ourselves getting less attracted to the material world and more attracted towards Krishna. This is a progressive development. just as you can measure how much we have recovered from a disease by measuring, say, fever or by your appetite. Similarly, we can measure our advancement in Krishna consciousness by seeing how much are we being attracted to Krishna. That is the test. Material desires may be there, and they will be there. But our idea is to increase that attraction to Krishna to such a degree that it will flood out, it will drown out all these material desires and leave them no scope for coming up in the future. Srila Prabhupada mentioned beautifully in one purport in one place that when a river floods its banks and the banks are inundated with water, then even if there are crops or seeds that have been planted in the soil, they cannot grow anymore because the ground is not flooded with water. The flood of water does not allow those seeds to sprout. And eventually those seeds will die out. Similarly, when we flood our heart with Krishna consciousness, with devotional service, with sincere efforts to become attracted towards Krishna, then that flood of attraction will drown out all those seeds of material desires in our heart, even though they're existing now, and even though they may trouble us every now and then. But if we continue on this path, then eventually those seeds will be rendered ineffective, they will die out, and our attraction for Krishna will emerge. So this is what we are expected to do. This is the important message that Prahlad is giving here. And the next part of the purport, Srila Prabhupada goes on to say, speaking about this natural attraction to Krishna, he says, the typical example of such attraction are found in Vrindavan, where everything and everyone is attracted by Krishna. The elderly persons like Nanda Maharaj and Yashoda Devi, the friends like Sudama, and the other cowherd boys, the gopis like Srimati Radharani and her associates, and even the birds, beasts, cows and calves are attracted. The flowers and fruits in the gardens are attracted. The waves of the Yamuna are attracted. And the land, sky, trees, plants, animals, and all other living beings are attracted by Krishna. This is a natural situation of everything in Vrindavan. Just see, this is Vrindavan. Vrindavan is a situation, it is a place where everything and everyone is attracted by Krishna. In Vrindavan, everything is conscious. And therefore, everyone and everything is a devotee of Krishna. The trees are devotees, the air is a devotee, the water is a devotee, the bees, the insects, the cows, the deer, the peacocks. What to speak of the gopas and the gopis? So Vrindavan is a state where the natural condition of the living entity has reached its highest stage of purity and perfection. There is no other place in the world, material or spiritual, where the attraction to Krishna is as intense and as sweet as it is in Vrindavan. I was in Mayapur recently and I was talking this very beautiful verse which Srila Rupa Goswami speaks about in the Bhakti Rasamrita Swami. Very interesting, where he talks about the attraction of Krishna. And one gopi is speaking to another gopi and she is cautioning her that this Krishna is too attractive, you better not go near him. If at all you have any interest in this material world, if you have any desire for enjoying this world, don't go to Krishna. Smeram Bhangir Chitam Sachir Sirna Krishim Vanchina Sadhar Shalaya Ujjalam Chandrakena Govindakhyam Haritam Vita Keshitirthopakante Maam Prekshishtha Savyadi Sathe Bandhu Sangve Sirangaha. So one gopi is warning the others. Ma prekshishtha, ma is Lord. No, don't see whom? Hari Tanumita Govinda Khyam. That person whose name is Govinda and he is directly Hari and he is standing at Keshighat, at Vamshibhata, on the bank of Yamuna. So, my dear friends, Bandhu Asti Rangaha Yadi, in case you have any attraction to the pleasures of this world, in case you have any attachment to your friends and family members, I warn you, don't go to the banks of the Yamuna at Keshighat, where there is a person called Govinda standing there. And what is he doing there, standing on the bank of the Yamuna at Keshighat? Sneha. He has a very light smile on his face. Bhangi Trayaparichita. His body is bent at three places. Bhangi means bent. Trayaparichita means at three places. Bhangi Trayaparichitam Sachi Vistirna Drishtim. He is casting sidelong glances which are like arrows which will pierce your heart. Smeram Bhangi Trayaparichitam Sachi Vistirna Drishtim Vanshi Nyasta Adhara Kishavayam. And he is holding a flute to his lips which are like freshly blossomed twigs. And he's holding the flute there and he's playing it. And his face is shining, Ujjalam, Chandrakena, because of the rays of the full moon. The full moon nights are especially considered nice, and especially in the month of autumn in Vrindavan. Sharad. The Sharad Ritu, the Sharad Purnima especially, is considered the most beautiful night in Vrindavan. The climate is just perfect. The full moon is shining and Krishna is there on the bank of the Yamuna playing the flute, standing in a threefold bending posture. So my dear gopis, don't go there. You will repent. You will regret it. Bhangi Trayaparichita, threefold bending form. Can you say in which three places Lord Krishna's transcendental body is bent? Neck, the waist, and the knees. Okay, so he's bent at three places. Actually, this idea of Trihanga, bent in three places, Hanga means bending, it is found very often in classical dance as well. Any of you who are familiar with classical dancing here? Any form of classical dancing? There are various poses in which the dancer can stand. So one is called Samabhanga, where the dancer is standing on two feet which are evenly balanced. So straight and evenly balanced, not left or not right. Then there is called Abhanga, where the dancer is slightly tilted to one side, left or right. Then there is called Atibhanga, where the dancer will bend the body in such a way that there is an extreme bending of the body. That is called Atibhanga. And there is Tribhanga. That form is preferred by Krishna. So he stands in Tribhanga, bending at three places. Alola Chandra Kala Sattva Namalya Vanshi Rasthana Chandrakala Satpana Malyavanshi. So he's wearing a necklace with a moon locket and he's playing the flute. He has held the flute in his hands and his hands are also decorated with the bracelets. Pashyanti Panti Kalyanti Chiranjanti. No, that's enough. Aloha Chandrakala Satpana Malyavanshi. Ratnangatam Pranayakeri Kalavilasam. So he's engaging in very playful pastimes of love with his devotees. Shyamam Trithambalalitam Niyata Prakasham. So this form of Krishna is Shyamasundar, where he's standing very gracefully in the threefold bending posture, is eternally manifest. So after this Govinda, I offer my respectful obeisances. This is what Brahma says in the Brahma Samhita. So this is the eternal posture of Lord Krishna as he stands. And he is at his attractive best. So the residents of Vrindavan, they are all attracted by his pose as he stands. And the Govardhan Leela, as I was mentioning a couple of days ago, was when Krishna was also standing in a threefold bending posture, but he was holding the Govardhan up with his little finger of the left hand. He had his arm, his right arm on his waist, standing in a very dashing pose, and he was smiling. How many of you have a smiling face when you're carrying your heavy luggage? Or how many of you have seen these weightlifters in the Olympics when they're lifting that very heavy weight smiling? And Krishna is lifting Govardhan Hill, which is so much more heavier than these weights. And he's smiling, enjoying himself. His knees are bent, his hip is bent, and he's smiling and holding his flute. Shyamam Trithanga Lalitam Niyata Prakasham. So all the residents of Vrindavan were extremely happy that they could see this form of Krishna all day and all night long for 7 consecutive days. Otherwise they were not able to see this. So when one gopi is warning the other gopi, don't go to Vanshiva, to Keshigar, to the banks of the Yamuna, where this person called Govinda is standing there playing the flute. What he's actually trying to say is, you definitely must go there. And the acharyas explain that this is an alankar, it is a metaphor in Sanskrit literature. It is called Vyaja Stuti. Vyaja Stuti means it is criticism that is actually intended to be praise. You criticize somebody, but actually you intend to praise that person. So sometimes in poetic language, such metaphors are used. So the gopis are actually intending to say, my dear friends, you must go there. Don't forget to go there. It is a perfection of our life to be attracted by that beautiful form of Krishna. So this is the most natural condition of the living entity's consciousness, to be attracted by Krishna. Now you may think, we're talking of Narasimha Dev, and here this Maharaj is talking about Krishna in Vrindavan. But there is no difference. The same Krishna has appeared as one Narasimha Dev, no? It's just that this, now Krishna, he takes on a different mood. He takes on a different form. After all, what Narasimha Dev is Bhakti Vidna Vinashaka. And Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur has offered many prayers to Lord Narasimha Dev, in which he petitions Lord Narasimha Dev, please remove the obstacles from the path of our devotion to Radha and Krishna in Vrindavan. So there is a very intimate connection between Lord Narasimha Dev and Radha and Krishna in Vrindavan. Even though the love of devotees of Narasimhadev is in the mood of awe and reverence. You cannot have that sense of intimacy towards Lord Narasimhadev as the devotees of Vrindavan have towards Krishna. In Vrindavan, the cowherd boys will climb on the shoulders of Krishna, they will steal his tiffin box, they will threaten him, they will tease him, the gopis will rebuke him, Mother Yashoda will scold him, she will tie him to the grinding mortar. Can you think of anybody doing all these things to Lord Narasimhadev? So in one sense, there is a great deal of difference between the worship of Lord Narasimhadev, which is in Vaikuntha, in a mood of awe and reverence, and the worship of Radha and Krishna, which is very intimate, very sweet. There is a great degree of familiarity that actually creates contempt, but in a transcendental platform. Transcendental contempt. So Madhu Mangala will criticize Krishna, threaten him, and he will taunt him. Okay, Krishna, you are no big deal. Just because you killed a few asuras, you think you are very great. Remember, I am a Brahmana. It is only because of my blessings that you have this power. So this kind of loving contempt, it is based on pure love. It is not contempt. It is not the familiarity breeding contempt that we find in this world. It is a very sweet kind of contempt. Something that is based on intense love for Krishna. So there is a deep connection between Narasimhadev and Radha Krishna as brought about by Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur. So we should pray to Lord Narasimhadev that, my dear Lord, your great devotee Prahlad has said in his wonderful prayers in Srimad Bhagavatam that his heart is attracted towards you like iron towards magnet, and your pure devotee Srila Prabhupada in the purport has said that the perfection of the acme, the zenith of this natural attraction is found in Vrindavan, and you are the remover of obstacles in the path of the devotion of your devotees. So kindly remove whatever obstacles may be there and let our hearts become Vrindavan. Mahaprabhu has said, Moramana Vrindavana. Let my heart become Vrindavan and let my heart become attracted to Radha and Krishna and their associates in the holy land of Vrindavan. So today we can pray to Prahlad, we can pray to Sri Narasimhadev that our natural attraction towards the Lord in Vrindavan will be aroused. Prabhupada also mentions in the other part of the purport, I'll quote here briefly, just contrary to the affairs of Vrindavan is a material world where no one is attracted by Krishna and everyone is attracted by Maya. This is the difference between the spiritual and the material worlds. Okay, so it's a long purport. So this is the perfection of our life. This is the kind of prayer that we can make to Lord Narasimhadev and also to Bhakta Prahlad on this day. Shri Narasimha Jayanti Maha Mahotsava Ki
Jai.
Shri Narasimhadev Bhagavan Ki
Jai.
Bhakta Raj Prahlad Maharaj Ki
Jai.
Nitai Gopranande
Ki.
Hare Krishna. So, any announcements? What time is the episode?